You guys are so handsome, they can't stop.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, man.
You're having fun.
It's the first go-round, man, of course.
Is this your first junket?
Yes, or...
Are you kind of did a half semi-one at yeah. the Telluride or some Toronto or something?
Yeah, Toronto.
So is he good at it?
Oh, he's killing it.
I'm just like feeding off every, you'll see like if it's a tough question, I just look to Andre.
And I look out the door. Like,
have you ever gotten, you're like kind of a mellow interviewee guy.
Yeah, I'm pretty mellow guy in general, I think.
You don't have like a shtick down or very defensive about interviews?
No, not at all.
Pretty wide open.
Pretty open dude, yeah.
So how did you get involved with this?
It was a typical audition process. I got the email and my manager called me and she was like, this is the best thing I'd ever read. You need to stop whatever you're doing and read this script. And it was indeed the best thing I ever read. Mm-hmm. And I went in for the audition. I auditioned for this guy's role, Kevin. Huh. And yeah, it was unique. And if you ask Barry, he'll say that I knew I was going in for the role of Chiron while using Kevin's words because the essence of the person was so not Kevin. Mm-hmm. But he stopped. Yeah, it was strange. But he stopped me halfway through and he was like, I'm going to do you a favor, bro. I want you to go home and come back tomorrow. I want you to read for the other role. And I did. And two auditions later, I got the role.
Hmm. What was it like reading Kevin's role?
It was different, but for whatever reason, I gravitated more towards Chiron. And so that was what was in my head and that was what I felt. And so that was the essence that I brought to the role of Kevin. And obviously seeing how Andre played Kevin, it was so wrong. And I'm so happy Barry was there because I would have just been shoved aside as like, no, you're just bad at acting as opposed to, you know, just the understanding being different. But yeah.
And when did you get the script on this?
I got it similarly. I got it sent it. We had done Selma, Plan B with Plan B, and Jeremy Kleiner called me up and was like, hey man, I've got this script and you know it's pretty incredible, take a look at it. And I looked at the cover page and I saw Barry's name on it, and he's a person I'd heard about for many years. And then it was co-written by a very good friend of mine, Terrell McCraney, who he and I have done like probably 7 plays together over the course of the last 10 years.
But you didn't do this one?
No. Well, Terrell co-wrote this as well.
But I mean, you didn't do the play that it was?
We never did this. It was never produced as a play, as a matter of fact, yeah.
Didn't know that.
Yeah, but
I didn't know that either.
Yeah, no, they never produced it. I'm not sure why, but it's a great play, but it just never got made. Maybe it will now. We'll see.
Right.
But yeah, so I auditioned, sent in the tape, and then got a call pretty quickly after saying that they wanted me to do it.
So are you still sending in tapes often? Is that?
Yeah, I mean it's
I kind of feel like everybody should know at this point.
He is the magnificent Andre Holland, people. Come on, man.
No, man, it's you know, people ask me that a lot. Like, do you audition? It's like, yeah, that's my job. You know, I mean, I would love to, you know, be able to sit back and field offers all day. But the truth is, like, the good stuff that's out there, a lot of people want it, and so you often have to fight for it.
Well, there are things that I can imagine you being asked to audition for.
Yeah.
But then you know, it's a small indie film. I'm sure there was no money and everything else. And,
you know,
it seems like when you make that phone call to you, you go, you know, can you please come?
Yeah, well, thank you. That's very nice that you would think that about me. I appreciate it. But I think that, you know, the reality of it is that, you know, especially with the small films, it seems to me that they often have that, you know, the pressure of like getting big names in them so that they can get the movies made. And, you know, I'm not a big name. And so often I'm like, you know, the third guy on the list or the fourth guy on the list, and I gotta fight for it. But but you know what? Like, I'm also like a craft guy. Like, I'm, you know, I love the work, and so I like doing the audition. I don't mind it. And also, I would hate to. One of my biggest nightmares is to be offered something and then turn up on set and disappoint everybody. I'd rather like show you ahead of time what I'm thinking and what I'm gonna do, and then you could decide if you want it or not.
Yeah. Did you know when you read this what it was or what you would do with it? I mean, was it?
I had a sense of it because, I mean, I knew it would be quiet and I knew it wasn't, you know, it's not a big explosive part. There's no big turning moment. There's no big monologue, you know, but it was an interesting challenge in that way, you know, to take a scene like the scenes that we have. It's like 30 minutes we're on camera together and not a lot happens. But how do you take that and make it interesting and make small things, small changes feel like big changes, you know? And I think we did a good job with that. So,
what is that? Is that what it feels like? I mean, are you guys basically like scene partners?
Yeah.
Like prepping a thing together? Is that the partnership?
Yeah, it was just this thing that we were cultivating at the same. Like together, we would be in, you know, the hotel room just rehearsing and trying to, I guess, live in that space before we, you know, gotten the opportunity to obviously live in the space. And yeah, man, just finding those little moments that were so incremental and like, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Yeah. And we, yeah, it felt like doing a play to me at times.
I've never done a play, but I would.
Yeah. Yeah. Because so much of it, Barry, you know, we ended up for the sake of time, we ended up block shooting a lot of things. So we did long runs of scenes instead of doing, you know, piecing it together. And that meant we had to be prepared in a certain way. You know, we had to like have it all down. And then we also had to understand what the architecture of the story was. We knew that, you know, the sort of climactic moment of our story, for me anyway, was the moment when I say, well, who are you? Who is you, Chiron?
That's like the phrase of the movie.
Yeah, you know what I mean? It is. Who are you? You know, that's the best, the question, right?
That's
and
the
so
question.
We had to put together like, all right, moment by moment, how do we get from, hey, I haven't seen you in so long, to me being able to ask him, who are you? And that was the fun of it, is crafting those little, like, those little moments.
Do you usually go through that process with another actor? Or is that usually something you're doing on your own, separate from the other actors?
A bit of both for me. I mean, I make my own decisions about what I think it is, but that, of course, when you get in the room with somebody, it all changes because they have their own ideas, you know?
You just be in that space with that person and understand and listen. And then everything else is, everything else that you did prior to being in that moment is gone. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's just like for me, I mean, it's like very interesting to hear Andre and to see Andre prepare for something, because I remember when we were again at the hotel, like rehearsing and everything, I would see his script and it was so riddled. Like he had so much information in it and he had so many thoughts in it. And I would look at mine and there was nothing. And I was like, man, I am like not good at this. I need to like up
it. Man.
And you know what I mean? But at the same time, it was like, then you get in the space and you just listen to one another and you just let what these people are thinking come to fruition, whether it's with words or without words, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And so it's just a unique thing. And then, like, I'm learning now that everybody has their own process and like everything is different and you come to the same conclusion, but it's just, yeah, that was something I was like, man, I need to get better at this. I need think of something, you know what I mean?
No, but it's like what you said, man. It's just, you know, I think it's just everybody has their own process, you know? And for me, a big part, one of the things I've always was told as a young actor is that acting is about revealing what you know. But that means that you have to know something. So for me, I like to put a lot of things in the bag, a lot of things, so that when those moments come, like the moment, for example, the moment you have with Naomi, you know, when you meet her in the third part and you're there and you know, we've talked about that moment, how like something in you seems to crack open and you, it becomes like an emotional scene. You obviously know a lot about that scenario, whether you wrote it down or not, you know a lot about it. So that when that collision happens, something natural comes out of you that's like, do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, notes or no notes, man, you knocked it out of the park.
Thank you, sir.
So did you feel going into it that you had process? Or were you just kind of like going from the heart and that was your way of approaching it?
I mean, honestly, that's how I approach everything. I approach everything just with my heart open, with my eyes open. And I mean, this is such a new journey for me, honestly. I mean, I've been acting like 3 years, I think. And so the only thing I know how to do is to read something and to personalize it, obviously, and put myself, or try my best to put myself in whoever situation that I'm, you know, trying to embody, embody whatever it is they're thinking and make that happen. And then for whatever reason, I'm an empathetic person. So I feel that I can relate to anybody on any level. And I don't know if, why or if that's even possible, but I do. You know what I mean? In any situation. And specifically with Chiron, it was so easy for me because, again, the script is so good that you see everything about the person, the beats that were in the script, the spacing that was in the script. You know who this person is. You know that this person doesn't speak often because he's insecure about so much. You know, he doesn't have the proper color palette to write the painting or to paint the painting that he needs to paint to show the world. You know what I mean? He doesn't have the tools. but he has the emotion, obviously. We all have the emotion. He's been through these events that have led him to be this person. You know, he has all these things that we all have. So it was so easy for me to kind of just navigate that by living and remembering things that I've gone through in my life and the relationships that I have with people. You know what I mean?
Is playing the silence hard?
No, it's liberating. Because, I mean, to me, it's like, you can lie with your mouth. Like, so, like I'm looking at someone and their eyes are saying one thing, but the mouth is going off and I'm just like, I don't care what you're saying to me, mm-hmm. because I'm looking at your eyes and I know what you're thinking is not at all what you're saying. And so to have the opportunity to convey the truth without having to say anything is amazing to me, because I feel like that is, we say the most important things, the best things with this. And I mean, again, like I said, this is nothing to me.
You got a few more words.
Me?
Yeah.
A few more words. Yeah, I got a few more words. Yeah.
You were the talker, but you also in this piece, I mean, I think everybody in this piece really, except for maybe Naomi's character, there's a lot, the silences are as important as the words.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. For sure. I mean, in some ways, you know, having words is like, can be a real burden, especially when you have a lot to say, and a lot of what you say is, you know, well, tell me about yourself. What have you been doing? Where mm-hmm. you been all this time? Yeah. Okay. How was that? Okay. With a lot of that questioning mm-hmm. stuff, it's very easy for that to be like exposition, or to just feel like, oh, I'm going to set it up so that we can learn this information that we need in order to go forward with right. the story. But like to take that stuff and to attach it to something personal, so that the question doesn't feel like just a question. It's actually like, you know, he's trying to move his life forward, or trying to like penetrate the other person mm-hmm. in some way, is a real challenge. And so, I don't know, I enjoyed it, you know? I enjoyed it very much. And it's funny, I was thinking while we were doing it about like what makes a scene work, you know? And sometimes it's the language and sometimes it's not. Mm-hmm. You know, like I think about that scene in Inglourious Basterds where, you know, we're in the house and Christoph Waltz is like giving that crazy speech. It's like he's doing all this stuff and it's amazing. And then the other guy in the scene who's sitting at the table, what's his name, that dude?
I don't know his
exactly.
name.
Nobody knows that dude's name.
Oh, man.
But that good. Scene does not work. The man that makes that scene work is the dude that's sitting there with his foot on that board.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's who makes the scene work.
Yeah.
Without him, you don't have a scene. And all he does is sit there, and then at one point, he just glances down. You know what I mean?
Yeah, man.
And I think, you know, I guess I said all that to say that, like, in some cases, it's the person who's sitting there quiet, who's doing the heavy lifting, and in other cases, it's the person who's doing the talking, but you kind of need both in order for it to work. And I think that, you know, we kind of found a nice balance, I think, at different parts of our act of like, all right, I'll take the ball now, and then, all right, you take the ball now, and we, you know what I mean?
The little bag or the little paper ball that they yeah. in the movie, that's what
yeah.
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That was
yeah,
very good, Andre. Yeah. I like that, you know. Glorious best. I was like, man, thank you for making that clear, man.
Wow, man. Balance, man. Balance.
See, I learn from this guy every day.
So when you were on the set of this movie, did you know when it was working and clicking? Was there a different...
I can't speak for anyone else, but I did. I would call my mom and my manager every night. I'm like, yo, this is incredible. I've never felt this sensation before. We're killing this. And then recently I've had conversations with Barry, and he was like, you weren't killing it until like the second or third day, man. So I don't know what you're talking about, but I'm like, what? So, I mean, for me, it felt, because everything was, again, so new and so fresh. Like, I've never felt what I felt on this film set. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I never felt the sensations that I felt. And so each day was something new. It was me doing something that I'd never done before. It was me experiencing these moments with people that I've, you know, obviously never experienced these moments with, and just really growing with that. So each day was just a new growth, and that's always, growths are so great, man. You know what I mean?
Mm. Yeah.
I think we have to start a national touring company of you guys in The Odd Couple. I think that would be
like, it's so strange, man.
Yeah,
and then the script, like, your characters are so...
But like, Andre's been so trained, and so like, he's had yeah. so much stuff, experience yeah. and everything else. And you're like completely from the heart, and it's like an interesting, and he is too. I mean, he brings you, yeah, bring your yeah. heart, but it's kind of yeah. very different ways of approaching it together that work so beautifully.
Right, yeah.
It's
yeah.
kind of unusual.
That is interesting. Yeah.
I think that's what that pairs us up, man.
Yeah.
It's like,
We balanced each other.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
We're like a battery.
Oh, a battery? Oh, the positive.
You know, the positive. I don't want to be the negative, though.
Nah.
I don't know. Sorry. So why acting? What got you into acting?
For me?
Yeah.
Honestly, because it was so... It's the same as athletics to me. It is the same exact thing, in particular track and field, because I ran track at the University of Texas. And in my last semester, I was noticed, and then I started acting or whatever. And I found that in acting, it is the most individualized team sport, just like track. In track and field, you train as best you can, and you can give your best race or whatever it may be, and you can still lose. Mm. In auditioning, you can train, give your best performance, but someone else could just be not necessarily better, but just be better for the role, and you still lose. And then when you book the role or you get on the race day and you train and you put forth your best race and you win the gold, that contributes to the team winning. So if you put forth your best performance, that contributes to the film being this, or hopefully being this great work of art. So it's the same thing to me. So I felt that in regards to what I've been doing my entire life with athletics, I just got to kind of continue that without like beating my body down and having like a short-lived...
Michael Bay hasn't found you yet.
Right.
He'll beat your body down. But I mean, were you always like a funny kid? Were you always a performer?
Like goofy. Like, and you know, I mean, now I could look back and say, like, oh, when I was 5, 6, 7 years old, I was pretending to be, you know, the Power Rangers mixed with the Ninja Turtles and jumping on the couches with my cousin and singing and then performing and stuff like that. But you just never, like, I thought that acting was something I thought it was like royalty. You know what I mean? You had to be born into it, or you had to have, like, some in already to kind of assume this role. You know what I mean? I didn't know that it was... I say simple, but I didn't know it was just as simple as getting an agent and going on an audition, which is not as simple as it sounds, but it is that simple.
Right.
You know what I mean? And I had no idea that was a possibility until college.
You're not just telling anybody it's that simple.
Right?
Because it wasn't that simple for most of them.
Sorry.
Not a lot of people premiering their work in Moonlight for movies like that.
Yeah. Barry Jenkins. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Barry Jenkins.
A lot of angry people.
Oh my, guys, don't be angry. Be like, I would rather be like a light to somebody like, yo, this guy just got into it and he is, you know, hopefully going to make some nice waves in the future. And if it's like that, I could do that too, you know what I mean? Or I can just do the same thing.
Well said.
Was it well said?
Yeah, very well
said.
Thanks,
man.
Yeah.
So when you guys got the script, was it, besides being good, did it feel important? And it's the conversation we just had with Janelle was about, you know, how she like...
What did she say?
She really felt like it was a very important film for LGBT and
right.
for as a black woman and all those things were like, that was right up front for her.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't just quality, you know, a quality story.
Mm-hmm.
It was
the content was great. Yeah.
Yeah, it felt important to me for sure. I mean, I read it and I can't remember reading or seeing a story like this, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I racked my brain to think about it. And there's a few things that came to mind, but nothing that really felt as like complete as this. Especially about like black gay men. You know, Paris is Burning is the last thing that came to mind. And that was a very long time ago and a very different thing, obviously.
Yeah.
But like, you know, yeah. But it's such a, especially having worked on these plays with Terrell, you know, all of his plays deal in the same sort of space, right? And identity and sexuality in the black community. And him being one of my closest friends, I've gone to a lot of places with him and we've, you know, spent a lot of time together. And I'm like, man, this is like a huge part of the culture. This is a huge part of the community, but nobody talks about it that I know of. People are very kind of like, you know, oh yeah, that over there. But like, I read it and I thought, well, yeah, it should be front and center. It's about time.
Has it changed slower in the black community than you think in the white community?
What do you mean?
That the acceptance of LGBT.
Has it changed slower in the black community?
Is it?
I would believe so. I mean,
It seems that way. I can't speak, you know, from any kind of like, you know, authoritative point of view, but it seems from my point of view like it has. And that probably, you know, religion is such a big part of the black community. Mm-hmm. The black church has been such a pillar of the community, and rightfully so, for a long time. But I think along with that has come a sort of homophobia, you know what I mean?
Absolutely, and with just being when you're groomed, you're told that you have to be that much more faster, stronger, more imposing, mm-hmm. more physical than the next man, just so you can reach the same level of succession. You know what I mean? Yeah. You have to be that much better than your counterparts because you already have this chip. You know what I mean? You're already born lesser. You know what I mean? So to have this hypermasculinity, it's not possible to have the vulnerability or to be sensitive or to be a homosexual. Mm-hmm. It's not possible mm-hmm. because those things don't, you can't be this with this. That's how, you know, you're brought up to be, you know, this how you brought up to mm-hmm. perceive like life. You know what
yeah.
I mean?
Yeah, and I think that applies also to just identity, not just as, you know, not just to homosexuality, but just identity in general. Mm-hmm. I feel like from such a young age, oftentimes in our community, in my community, I'll speak for myself, there was that, you know, this thing of, well, you know, come on, you know, toughen up. Yeah. But don't be too tough because you don't want to be threatening, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, yeah, you know, speak your mind. Yeah, but don't be angry because there's danger in that. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And I think that black men in particular have had to toe this really delicate line for a very long time. And we still see with all the things that are happening today, there's still a real danger, you know, and you know, in like wearing black skin, frankly. Mm-hmm. And I think that I would imagine that being a homosexual black man growing up in that kind of environment would only compound that, mm-hmm. you know, because none of those things get you closer to yourself. That's all about the things you have to be in order to survive, mm-hmm. you know? And so I think this movie really is about, and that's my favorite part of the movie is the very end, because I feel like the end, they both arrive at a place where they can actually start their lives from an authentic place, you know what I mean? Yeah. And they had to pay a real cost to get to that point. And there are a lot of people who don't get to that point because they don't have the tools, or they don't have a second chance, or they don't have a person to talk to or to relate to. They fall through the cracks, you know? So that to me, that moment then where they're just embracing each other, you know, and you see black walking out into the moonlight, and he just looks back, and the look on his face to me, I get choked up just thinking about it, but the look on his face to me, it's just like, it might be okay. You know, there's something out there for me, yeah. maybe.
But, what's interesting mm-hmm. is the way the movie's a triptych, it's also, it takes three people
to do it,
to be there for him.
Yeah.
To help him get to that place.
Great point, yeah.
And that's interesting structure of the movie. I mean, cause it's one of the, that's, I love the ending, but I mean, the lack of judgment early in the movie, in the first section of the movie, is also kind of glorious.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing to watch.
Yeah.
And you don't expect that anywhere, you know, like from anybody. And it's kind of like interesting. I don't know. It's fascinating because we watch Obama, and like Obama's the embodiment of that kind of walking that line
mm-hmm.
and don't be an angry black person, you know, even though, you know, he just wants to tell Donald Trump to go fuck himself at some point. But he just can't be that guy because he's, you know, and the other hand, he's also like above that angry, you know, there's something magical about him also. That's mm-hmm. It's kind of fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's so hard to, I mean, it's, I don't know. It's a weird time because as a white person, it's very, the things we don't know and the things we haven't lived and the things we don't see,
yeah.
Are you can't figure that out. You know, it's like right. You can't prove a negative. It's just hard to know.
But that's why I think movies like this are great. And that's why I feel like this movie isn't just a movie for the black community. It's one for everybody. There's something for everybody. It's an access point for everybody in this movie. I really believe that. And I can't say that about many things. That's why I hope, really in my heart, that everybody comes to see this film. I really hope they do.
Well, there is a universality of it, even absolutely. Though it's about being the other as much as it is about being black or gay.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
And we all know what that is, don't we?
Everybody.
Yeah.
At some point in their lives, to some extent.
So did you know that more about this, having, after you, when you saw the movie put together?
More
you
about,
made it,
more about
or did you know it from reading the script?
Well, oh, about these things that we're talking about in terms of how
the bigger picture.
I mean, to be honest, I mean, I sensed it. I sensed that it was there. But
reading the script.
Yeah, but until you like seeing it for me, really, is what kind of I went. Right. Oh wow, what Barry was doing was actually way more sophisticated and complicated than I think I understood at the time. You know,
still don't. I've seen it like 7 or 8 times, and every time I see it, it's something else mm-hmm. that you take from it
mm-hmm.
because. Barry is a mastermind, man. Barry is Van Gogh. Like, Barry is incredible.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think you really have to sit and watch it a few times and pay attention to the most minute details to understand even more how just universal it is. You know what I mean? Because everybody at, you know, but at some point in the film, they can pick a 5-minute little increment that relates to them so heavily. And I feel like literally everybody in the world can pick a point in the film that's like, that is my life, exactly. Except for us, you know, a little black kid. But you know what I mean? Like, everybody can find that moment. Mm-hmm. And that's insane how you can, I don't know, that's crazy to me how you can do that with cinema, how you can do that with art in general. You know what I mean? That's, I don't know.
Well, that's kind of the glory of cinema, isn't it?
That's the glory of cinema,
yeah. You can play every which way. Yeah. When did you guys see the movie the first time?
I saw it, it wasn't color corrected, probably about 3 months ago. Yeah. 3 months ago in LA.
By yourself in a room, or?
No, it was, Marshall was there, Ashton was there, Barry obviously was there, and it was at the Plan B screening room. Yeah.
So, freaky experience? Comfortable
for
experience?
Me, yeah, because it was the first time I saw my face on this big, and it was like I was shaking, and then there were a few other people in there as well who came up to me, and the genuflection was there, and I was just like, why are you telling me that this is, thank you so much, this is incredible, because at that point it was more of a selfish thing for me. It was more like doing the work was just so therapeutic to like kind of exhaust. Like, I feel like I have, you know, 3 or 4% of Sharon in me, and I felt like I got to really live 100% of that 3 or 4%. You know what I mean? So for me, it was just like this therapeutic thing to kind of like exhaust and like live that part of myself and understand that part of myself now. And I mean, I was done with it. And so to see it again, it was kind of like, and to see it with people, it was kind of like reliving that sensation and living it through other people and seeing that in their eyes that they felt something that I felt whenever I was doing it. Mm-hmm. If that makes any sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
But, and so that was just, that sensation was just amplified in that, to see that people were genuinely, not just to be like, oh man, that was a good job, good job. But it was genuine, mm-hmm. that it touched them. That was just, and yeah, man, and then that's just been continuing. Mm-hmm. And it just, yeah, it's good stuff, man. I'm on a cloud 12 million.
Yeah. Right. And did you see it in a room somewhere also?
Yeah, or? I saw an early cut about the same time in New York though, in a room with Barry and Terrell, mm-hmm. and Barry's lawyer. And I was panicked. After it was over, I was like, man, I quit. I'm never going to act again. I'm done.
You didn't like what you...
Nah, man, I was like...
What?
Heartbroken. I was like, yeah, because I don't like watching stuff that I do. I really, really don't like it. And most of the time, I don't watch it. But I really wanted to see this one, so I did.
And why? I'm sorry to...
No.
Why do you... Why? Because I feel like watching the work is like watching game film. Like,
yeah,
I need
yeah.
to see. And yeah, see you have you moments where you're like, damn, I wish I could have did that better.
Yeah.
Freak, I wish I would have. But, I mean, understanding that you can't do anything about that, that it's been done.
Right,
you
know what right.
I mean? And kind of seeing it. And, like, obviously, I feel like all actors kind of, at least I do, like, I see a performance and I nitpick the hell out of it, mm-hmm. especially if I like it.
Yeah.
You know what
yeah.
I mean? I can't say I like my own performance because that's pretentious as shit. But, you know, seeing stuff that I like, and especially with it being something that I was in, I was just like, I feel like you need to at least watch it 2 or 3 times to understand where you were at that point in your life, mm-hmm. and try to progress. But I don't know anything from anything. You know?
No, that's no man. Most people feel that way, I think, and mm-hmm. I think that's true. Like most people want to see what they're, you know, what they're doing and how right. it's landing. But it's just, you know, for me, the fun is like the doing of it. You know what I mean? Like, that's to me is the best part. Like, being there and like working it out and being on set and figuring out, and then watching it is all, to me, is always a little bit disappointing, because
right.
all I think of is the things that didn't make it in.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Or like, I wish I had done this instead of that, or I didn't know he was gonna do it like that.
So has it gotten better?
Yeah, oh, it's gotten so much better after I saw it. After that, listen, after I saw it the first time, I just felt that way because
I hated the first cut, but now I love it.
No. You know? To be clear, I loved the cut of the movie the first time. I just didn't love myself in it the first time. I thought everybody is great, and I think I've messed up. That was what I thought at first. But then when I went back and watched it again, I was like, oh, wait a minute. Okay,
I did my thing.
It's all right. No, I was like, it's okay. You know, the story holds. But I've watched it 2 or 3 times since then, and you know, and
you actually, see it with an audience.
Yeah, I saw it in the audience. It's like, okay, that's a different experience too. Like people laugh at moments like, oh wow, I thought that was funny that's too. I guess people do think it's funny, but
people laugh at the taking out the grill, and I've never, every time people laugh
at that moment.
And I have no idea why that's funny.
Yeah,
it was literally like, we just take it out so we can eat. Barry's like, that's what's so beautiful about it. You got to take them out to eat. And I'm like, what are you talking about? I don't understand. I know you're trying to, like, you know, sensei me right now, but I have no idea what you mean.
Yeah.
But
you have an audience of a lot of people who've never seen grills.
This is true.
This is true. I don't think there's one grill in Telluride.
This is true. No.
Except for a very posh one.
Yeah, exactly.
So can you feel the audience going with it? When you guys have seen it with them?
Oh yeah.
Man, I can't focus on that. Like I'm a people pleaser, like insanely. So whenever I would look at somebody, I was just like, please enjoy the film. So I just like, just look back at the screen and not pay attention. Try to like block out everybody else because that would kill me. Because if there's a moment where I think it's good and somebody's just sit there and they're like going to sleep, I would really want to get up and like slap them or something. And I know I can't. And that's honest. Like I can't pay attention to that because I know I'm very impulsive and I would do something stupid. So I'm just being honest, man. I would at least say, yo, man, can you just please like wake up or something? So I just.
Somebody was slapped at the Chuck Jones Theater. Nobody knows who it was. There was a ham. But you did feel the audience.
Yeah, I can't wait for you to do a play.
Oh man,
you got a Shakespeare play, and you hear the
walk off the stage. Yeah,
exactly.
Who is it?
No,
I probably Patti LuPone does that.
Yeah.
Wait, who?
Patti LuPone. She's
like Broadway diva.
For real?
Yeah, yeah. Like if people are like on their phones and stuff. Yeah,
she'll stop the show.
Yeah, I gotta go to his.
I was in a play one time, and this actor, he was in the middle of this amazing monologue, and somebody in the balcony was opening something, like they had like a sandwich or something, trying to get out, and you kept hearing, and this man's in the middle of this monologue, tears, like giving it to the world, and he just stops and turns and says, "Excuse me, whatever it is you're opening, would you mind just getting it open, please? We'll wait." And the whole audience waited. Everybody applauded, and then when the guy called, he's like, "Thank you." And he went right back into the mud.
Right back into it.
I was like, that's a bad man.
That's a bad money job.
But when we saw it in Telluride, I remember sitting there thinking, like, I mean, it was so quiet. You could hear a pin drop in that theater.
Telluride.
You could not hear a thing. And I thought, man, they either love this movie or they are asleep. I don't know which one it is. But then once the lights came on or the credits came on, people just leapt to their feet and clapped and wouldn't sit down. And I was like, man, we got something special.
No. It's very emotional for a lot of people.
Yeah, myself included.
The first person who told me how was the greatest movie of one of the great movies of the year was a white woman.
Yeah, good.
From Hollywood. It was like, you know, oh my God. And I'm like, once I saw the movie, I was like, how did she identify with this movie? But then you realize. There's that universality to it.
Yeah.
Being the other connects.
Being the other.
Yeah.
And everybody is, it was just strange to me, like everybody's the other, so how are any of us the other?
Mm.
You know what I mean, I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't understand stuff.
Yeah, no.
Just talk it out, man.
Yeah. It'll all come to you. Or maybe it shouldn't because you're just going by
hopefully
your
instinct. Hopefully not, yeah, because learning is the best part about it. So, yeah.
Thank you guys so much for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Mr. Paul, appreciate it.
Nice.
Pleasure talking to you.
As ever.
All right.
Are we the only ones? You got more people.
There are more people coming.
All right. It never stops.
It's a parade. We're headed down.